So last time we had looked at the Kronig-Penney model, which was an exactly solvable model for band structure. So just to remind you, the ultimate goal of what we are doing currently is to understand the energy eigenvalues and the eigenfunctions of electrons in a periodic potential. Okay, it's a spatially periodic potential. And basically, we are trying to solve the eigenvalue, which means that we want to solve this problem, h psi is equal to e psi, where the h has periodicity. Okay, so in this connection, if this is given to us, so this is the general mathematical problem that we are trying to solve, the Schrodinger's equation with a Hamiltonian, which has a periodic potential, or which is periodic in space. So then we said that Bloch's theorem applies to the wave functions. Okay, and we had taken one specific example of a periodic potential, which was a sequence of barriers, and that was called the Kronig-Penney model, and we solved that exactly. Okay, so by solving it exactly, we could see that there were certain energy values which are not allowed, and also that the Ek was a continuous function of K in the Brillouin zone. Okay, and at the ends of the Brillouin zone, there were gaps that arose, and so on. Okay, so today we will look at another method to arrive at the band structure, and that is called the tight binding method. Okay, and it's a very powerful method, as I had said earlier also, and there is a certain philosophy to this. Okay, so let me, yeah.
I have a question from Kronig-Penney model.
Okay.
What we got in from the last equation, that for certain energy values, there is no Bloch wave solution.
For certain K values, for certain energy values, yes, there is no Bloch wave solution, correct.
That means no traveling wave solution.
That's correct, yeah.
So what happens in the band gap here? I mean, is there a standing wave due to Bragg deflection?
Exactly. So I did not go into the details there. In fact, some of that will be covered in your assignments. But essentially what is happening is, due to Bragg deflection, there's going to be standing wave formation because the gradient of the dispersion is going to zero there. And exactly at those points, you see a mixing of the two bands. Essentially, if you look at the free electron picture, then you see this kind of a picture. And this is the region where there is a avoided crossing. Okay, so this is where you see the band formation. And did not go into details into that deliberately. But okay, what we could do is, later on we can take this up and go into the details of the band gaps and so on. Okay.
Okay.
Okay. So, but just wait for the assignment, and after that we can discuss. Yeah.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
So today we'll discuss this method called the tight binding method.
Hello, sir.
Yes.
Sorry for interrupting. Can you go back to the plot you showed yesterday?
Sure.
The plot of energy versus crystal momentum, E versus. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Yeah, I will show you that. One second. Yeah, so this is the function versus Ka, but this is not what you want. You want E versus K, right? Yeah, this one.
Yes, sir. This one. How this plot was, how did you come to this plot?
Yeah, sure. I can describe that. So, a minute. I'll show you the program. Okay, it's a very simple program. So what essentially we are doing is that we are looking at the left-hand side function. I'll show you where that left-hand side function is calculated. So do you see this line, y equal to q squared minus k squared over 2 into qk into sine hyperbolic of qb into sine of ka, and then to this we are adding cos hyperbolic of qb into cos of ka. Okay, so let me remind you what the equation was. I myself don't remember it exactly. Yeah, I have it written here. One second. So you want to know the algorithm, right?
No, sir. What I want to know is, how can we, for a given crystal momentum, mm-hmm. we are actually calculating the allowed energy values for the electrons.
Correct.
So how can you go from this equation to the another?
Got it. Yeah. Okay. So what we know here is our A and B, right? We know that. So we are choosing the values of A and B. Okay. That we had taken was that what I told you was, suppose you choose a certain value of K, right? Then you have to find out what are the possible capital K values which will satisfy this equation, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Right? Now, this is actually a highly nonlinear equation, right? And if you look at the left-hand side, then I can write it as F of K, okay? And the right hand side, I can write it as g of small k, correct?
Yes, sir.
Now, if you choose this value, then you know that there is some constant here, which is between minus 1 to 1. You agree?
Yes, sir.
So the problem reduces to finding certain values of the capital K, which satisfies f of capital K equal to c. Correct?
Okay.
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 But this is actually a very difficult problem, okay? Trying to invert this f function to find out multiple values of the k which satisfy this is a very difficult problem. So we solve this problem in a different way, okay? What we do is we take the values of ka to be continuous. So in some sense, what I'm saying is, let's take this ka as the axis, okay? And for all values of Ka, what I will do is, I will find out the value of the left-hand side function, which is why I showed you the first part. Okay.
Yes.
The left-hand side function, I will plot it as a function of Ka. Okay. Then for each Ka, when I find out the function value, let's say it is some value, which is 0.7. Okay.
Okay.
Then this 0.7, I will equate it to cos of small k into a plus b and invert that to get the small k. That is easy, because the small k into a plus b will be just cos inverse of the f of capital K divided by a plus b. Sorry, this a plus b is already here. So this is a plus b. So if I know capital K, I can find the small k very easily. But the inverse is very hard. If I know small k and I want to find capital K, that's a hard problem. Okay.
Okay.
But the reverse problem is very easy, because the reverse problem involves only doing the cos inverse.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay.
Right. So what I'll do is, I will scan the Ka axis, and for each value of the Ka, I will find out what is the left hand side. And then if it is between minus 1 to 1, I will take the cos inverse of that and then divide it by a plus b to get the small k. Okay, so from this, I can convert this axis to the small k axis. Okay?
Okay,
and then flip the axis. So this I can then convert to the ek, because this ek is just h cross squared k squared by 2m. And in the Python program, I have taken h cross is 1 and m is half. So basically ek becomes just k squared. Okay, it's just proportionality constant, doesn't matter. So ek becomes just k squared, and you can then flip the axis to plot ek versus small k. That's the idea.
Okay, so essentially ek is the capital K part.
Ek is the capital K part, no? Yeah. Because that is what we started, right?
Yeah. Okay, sir.
So energy is defined as h cross squared k squared by 2m. So in some sense, you are defining an auxiliary momentum to represent the energy. So but E is the energy eigenvalue, remember that. And what we are doing is, we are creating a correspondence between the crystal momentum and the energy. So which energy satisfies this, that becomes the eigen energy of the problem.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Sure. Any other doubts? Okay. Yeah, so I was going to explain the philosophy of the tight binding method. Now, okay, so it actually goes back to the very foundations of quantum mechanics. Okay, the foundations, I mean, one of the things that is characteristic of quantum mechanics is this relation. All of you know this, okay? But what is the meaning of this? This delta x and delta p are essentially characteristics of particles and waves, okay? Or in some sense, the we can also write wave-particle duality as being characteristic of quantum mechanics. But what is the essential difference, okay? When we talk about a particle, we mean that there is a certain location for the particle. Okay, so there is a certain position or there is some kind of a localization. Okay, but when we talk about a wave, then a wave is not localized somewhere. It's a delocalized entity, right? A particle is a localized entity versus a wave is a delocalized entity. So you see, there is a duality in quantum mechanics which talks about the simultaneous existence of a delocalized entity as well as a localized entity. Okay, and in many systems, what happens is there are interactions which tend to either localize the entities present in the system or they tend to delocalize the entities present in the system. Okay, so one example is Coulomb repulsion and kinetic energy. Okay, so suppose I take a system where there is kinetic energy, but there is also potential energy in the form of Coulomb repulsion. Okay, so Coulomb repulsion between electrons tends to localize them, because suppose I give you a free system of electrons and I confine them within some system, then if the electrons are strongly interacting, they will just go and sit in some places and form something called a Wigner crystal. Okay, and if you add to that some kinetic energy, then there could be a competition between the localizing agency, which is the Coulomb repulsion, and the delocalizing agency, which is the kinetic energy. Okay, so, and there are many systems which are like this. So there is always a competition between localization and delocalization. So the question is, suppose I want to solve such a problem where there is a delocalizing term and there is a localizing term, right? And it so happens that one of the terms can dominate. So in some systems, for example, like if you take gold or silver, the delocalizing terms are dominating. That is why you get almost free electrons. Okay? But in certain other systems, for example, you can take orthoferrites or many of these oxide systems, where the system is an insulator, but it is not a band insulator. Okay, it's an insulator because the electrons repel each other very strongly and they get localized onto individual sites and they cannot move. Okay, so it's the Coulomb repulsion between electrons that dominates over the kinetic energy part. Right, so the question then becomes, like, what is the starting point of my problem? Okay, should I start with kinetic energy as the dominating term and include the potential energy as a perturbation, or should I start with the potential energy term and use the kinetic energy as a perturbation? Okay, and these two approaches are actually mutually exclusive. And the mutual exclusivity arises actually from the basis of quantum mechanics, which is the wave-particle duality. Okay, so in some sense, the kinetic energy part represents the wave part. Okay, and this represents the particle part. Right, and there is a competition in the system to either, you know, turn the excitations into waves or into particles. Right. And in each of these cases, the theoretical approach which can be used to solve the system becomes different. So how different it is, okay? So let me give you an example. Suppose I'm trying to solve the problem of a metal, okay, with free electrons. As you have seen, if it's a periodic potential, then the Bloch's theorem applies, okay? and there is a new quantum number that comes up, which is the crystal momentum. And each of these wave functions, the eigenfunctions, is characterized by this crystal momentum k, and you also have a dispersion in terms of this k index. Okay, but you also realize simultaneously that these indices, the k index, immediately signifies that these wave functions are actually delocalized. Okay, they are extended throughout space and they arise because electrons are being treated as waves. Okay, but there is an alternative approach where I can start with the atomic limit. So what do I mean by this? Suppose I start with a system where the atoms are very far to begin with. Okay, so they are placed so far that none of the wave functions of this atom overlap with the wave functions of the next atom, right? So if there is absolutely no overlap, or there is an exponentially small overlap, then there is no chance that the electrons on this can hop to the next atom. Okay, now imagine, you know, this is a thought experiment, bringing each of these atoms closer to each other. Okay, and close enough so that the wave functions start to overlap, right? If the wave functions start to overlap between these two, then the electrons on this atom, on the second atom, can feel the attraction due to the nucleus on the first atom, right? And if that starts to happen, then there is going to be a band formation. Okay, so what you see here is the other limit, where I'm starting from the atoms being completely separate and independent, then using the mixing between the wave functions, or the interaction between one nucleus and the other electrons, as the perturbation to treat the system. Okay, and this is the philosophy of the tight binding method. The first method that we started with, where in the Kronig-Penney model, for example, we took the electrons as waves and then we treated that as a barrier problem. Okay, that is the other approach, where we are treating the kinetic energy as the primary term, as the dominant term. Okay, but here in the tight binding method, it's the other way around. We use a basis of our problem, which is a localized basis. It's not a delocalized basis. Okay, and choosing a localized basis means that you're starting from a limit where the atoms are completely separate from each other and there is absolutely no mixing. And the mixing terms of the electrons with other atoms being added as a perturbation. Okay, so when I write these terms, then it will become more clearer. So let me just do that. And then if you have any questions, then let me know. So what we are saying here is the following. Let's treat the crystal as some H free, okay, plus the U of R, okay. But in other words, I could also write this as H plus some delta U of R. Okay, these are two alternative expressions. Where here we are writing the Hamiltonian in one part where there is free electrons, and then we add a periodic potential. Okay, but now we are writing it in a different way. So this is one possible way, this is another possible way. In this way, what we have done is we have written the atomic Hamiltonian separately for each one of the atoms, and then we are adding the extra part, which is the kinetic energy part or the mixing part, for example, as the perturbation. Okay, so this is the tight binding approach. Okay, and this is the Bloch's theorem approach. It's not that the Bloch's theorem is inapplicable in this case. It is applicable, okay, but the basis from which you're starting are atomic states, which means they are states where the atoms are completely separated from each other. Okay, whereas in this case, you're starting with a system where there are no atoms. Okay, there is no atomic potential at all. So it's a system of free electrons. And then on top of this, you're just superimposing a periodic potential. Okay, so this is the Bloch's theorem approach. Are these two approaches clear? And is the philosophy of the tight binding approach also clear? See, these are very general statements. They don't require you to, you know, understand any mathematics. Very general statements. So these are the kind of statements you must remember after this course. That is the tight binding approach. When we say tight binding, it means that we are trying to bind these atoms together. Okay, and it's as if we are starting from a state where the atoms are completely separated and far from each other, and you're bringing them closer and closer, and that's how you're forming the crystal. Whereas in the alternative approach, you're starting from an empty box, and inside the empty box, you're introducing a periodic potential. Okay. In the second case, the box is infinite to begin with, and you're shrinking the box and bringing the atoms closer to each other. That is the tight binding approach. Is this clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Sorry. Yeah, so let's go ahead with this and talk about how do we actually implement this, okay? So essentially what we are doing is we are taking the, when we break a problem, we usually do it in this way, okay? This is the exactly solvable part, okay? And this we call as the perturbation, the second piece, okay? So this is what we are doing here. We are now taking the Hamiltonian and breaking it into the atomic part plus some extra piece. And you can see this involves a lot of things, okay? We have not exactly specified what this is, and we will come to this, okay? But you can see that this actually involves the kinetic energy part. This also involves the potentials on a particular site due to all the other atoms. Okay, so this is a complicated part, and we have not written it. Okay, we'll write it in full detail. But what does this atomic Hamiltonian have as its basis? Okay, so it will have some eigenfunctions. So what would be the nature of these eigenfunctions? Let's just discuss that, okay? So suppose I had a lattice of hydrogen atoms. So the simplest possible thing, these are all hydrogen atoms, okay? And now, Anastup, are you online?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So, Anastha, what are the eigenfunctions for the hydrogen atom problem?
Spherical harmonics for the angular part.
Okay.
And the radial part is exponential logger.
Correct. So, basically, you're saying that how do we represent these wave functions? They have some names, right?
Yes. I mean,
they have some quantum numbers. So, we call them 1s. Right?
Yes, sir.
2s, yes, sir. 2p, and so on. Okay. And each of these represent different wave functions. And it also turns out that there is a degeneracy in terms of energy eigenvalues, correct?
Yes, sir.
Hmm. So, as you said, the p will have some non-trivial angular dependence, whereas the s is spherically symmetric. It has no angular dependence, correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, this p has triple degeneracy, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, but the angular dependence is different. So, do you think that, that is not the right question to ask at this point. But for this problem, H is equal to H atomic plus delta U of R, can I choose the atomic states as the basis?
I guess so, yes.
Okay, so if I bring two hydrogen atoms closer, okay?
Yes, sir.
Are you a chemistry student or physics student?
Chemistry student.
Chemistry. So you know this molecular orbital theory very well, right?
Yes, sir.
Right? So the 1s orbitals of these two, if they start to mix with each other, right? You do,
yes,
something called LCAO, right? That's,
yes,
the crude level of approximation that you do. So this is linear combination of atomic orbitals. Correct?
Yes, sir.
And using this, you arrive at orbital, isn't it? You get a bonding orbital and you get an antibonding orbital.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So here what we are doing is we are not bringing two atoms closer, but we are bringing 10 to the power 23 atoms closer to each other.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Can we use the same principle here, LCAO, to solve this problem?
I don't know, sir. Band theory generally, we know that band theory is formed by mixing of atomic orbitals. Like when we have a large number of atoms, those MOs actually form bands.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it can be done.
It can be done, right?
Yes, sir.
Yes, it can be done. Very nice. Okay, thanks. You can mute yourself. So the LCO is what essentially we will be using to solve this problem also. Okay, basically we will be constructing a linear combination of certain orbitals to create localized wave functions. Okay, so what do I mean by that? Now, since we have done the Bloch's theorem, we will start with the Bloch's theorem. We will start with the Bloch wave functions and then construct localized wave functions out of that, which appear to be like atomic wave functions. Okay. So essentially what I'm saying is that, let's say if we had a crystal, okay, and we know that we have the Bloch's theorem, which gives us wave functions that depend on the band index and the crystal momentum. So these are the eigenfunctions. Okay. And these eigenfunctions are delocalized in space. But we are trying to solve a problem where the electrons are probably more, they can be described better as being localized rather than being delocalized. Okay. Now, let me give you an example. There is a certain material called uranium germanium 2. Okay. It so happens that at a certain pressure, I think, if you bring down the temperature, okay, then it's a metal to begin with, then it goes to a ferromagnet and it becomes a superconductor. Okay. Now see what is happening. This system, as you're decreasing temperature, the system was a metal at high temperature, but becomes a ferromagnet at low temperature. And then that ferromagnetism gives rise to superconductivity, or it leads to superconductivity. Okay. In these systems, what happens is that the electrons are actually close to magnetism. So when a system magnetically orders, it means that the electrons are sitting in one place and their spins are ordered. So for example, if I want to represent a ferromagnet, I represent it like this. But in this system, in the ferromagnetic system, there are no free electrons in that sense. Okay. So the electrons are sitting at fixed positions and they have certain fixed orientation of the spin. But if I look at a metal, then in the metal, there are free electrons, which are, you know, itinerant. Itinerant means they are delocalized. And their spins are not fixed. There could be spin flips, for example, and their spins are not aligned in one particular direction. So when a metal becomes a ferromagnet, there is a phase transition. But just because we decrease the temperature, the metal became a ferromagnet. What that means is that there was already a strong interaction between these electron spins. And just by decreasing the temperature, we tilted the computation in favor of the magnetism. Okay. So in these systems, the interaction between electrons was already very strong. And we, by decreasing the temperature, we tilted the computation one way or the other. Right. So in this system, it makes sense to start with a limit where the electrons are already localized. And then you introduce interactions which can delocalize the electrons. And the reason is that the delocalization is actually very weak. Okay. These electrons, if you measure the effective mass of these electrons in this system, it will turn out to be very high. So if the effective mass is very high, then the electrons are pretty close to being localized. Okay. And once you decrease the temperature and they become magnetic, the system becomes magnetic, the effective mass diverges and becomes infinity. Okay. So there are many such systems where the electrons are close to some kind of magnetic ordering, maybe antiferromagnetism, ferromagnetism, ferrimagnetism, and things like that. And by tuning pressure, temperature, magnetic field, one is able to tune the system from a magnetically ordered state to a non-magnetic state or vice versa. Okay. So in such systems, it makes sense to start with a limit where the electrons are already localized on atomic states. Okay. And you introduce interactions between the different sites as a perturbation. The kinetic energy term becomes a perturbation. Okay. So the question is, how do you construct wave functions which are strongly localized on a particular site, okay, or on a few sites, right? How to start from the block wave functions and construct such wave functions which are maximally localized, okay? And to do that, there is a concept called maximally localized Wannier function. Sorry, the tight binding method is not taught usually in this way, but I thought that there are several reasons why we do the tight binding method. Okay, and one of the reasons why we do this tight binding method is because that becomes the natural starting point for treating systems which have very strong interactions between the electrons. Okay, and there are a large number of such systems. So the tight binding method also forms a basis for many of the calculations involving, let's say, real space systems. So for example, if I want to treat a system which has a molecule, sandwiched between, let's say, two electrodes, say these are gold electrodes, okay? And I want to solve this problem. Then also, I want to treat first the atoms as being, because this is a real space problem, this is not a k-space problem. So I want to treat the atoms as being separate, okay? Then create interactions or then add interactions which will delocalize the electrons among the gold electrode. And then find out the mixing elements between the molecule and the gold electrode, and then solve the entire problem as a matrix problem. Okay, so this is routinely done, for example, in Professor Sopanpathy's group. Okay, where he has treated, he has looked at several problems, and this area is called molecular electronics. Okay, so this is a routinely done thing. In my group, for example, we take tight binding models of bulk systems which are strongly interacting, called strongly correlated electron systems. And then starting from the tight binding model, we add interactions on top of that to understand how do interactions change the basic band structure of the system. Can they lead to new gaps? Can they lead to new phase transitions? Can they lead to new magnetic order? Can it lead to superconductivity and things like that? Okay. So the tight binding method forms essentially a basis for systems where you want to start from the isolated atom limit, and then you add perturbations which mix the different sites and lets the electrons become itinerant. Okay, so that's the basic idea. So what we want to do is to construct maximally localized Wannier orbitals. Okay, and these maximally localized Wannier orbitals would be localized mostly on single site, like this. For example, okay, and there is very little overlap between the two Wannier orbitals on two different sites, right? So this can be done by using the block wave functions, by using the block eigenfunctions in the following way. So I can use this, okay, and this is e to the power I k dot r dash psi n atomic of r minus r dash. Okay, suppose I define something in this way. Okay, then if I claim that this satisfies the Bloch's theorem. Okay, so Purnendu, are you online?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So can you show me that this wave function that we have written here, it actually satisfies the Bloch's theorem? How do we show this? What do I need to show that this wave function that I've written here actually satisfies the Bloch's theorem? I'll explain the meaning. Go on.
That part, I mean, psi n of r minus r prime, that has to be periodic.
No. See, this one is an atomic wave function, which is localized on the site n. Okay. And what we are doing is that we are doing a kind of a Fourier transform. Okay. It's a discrete Fourier transform. You see what we are doing? Okay. So we are taking a particular point r, right? And then taking atoms sitting at different positions n, and then doing a Fourier transform. Okay. So what we want to show is this. See, remember the Bloch's theorem, we have to show this, right? E to the power I k dot r.
K dot r psi k of n.
K of r, right?
Yes, sir.
So the question is, does this wave function satisfy this? How do we show this? Remember, this sum over r dash is a sum over all the sites in the crystal. So let's just substitute, okay? Let's just go through this. So if I do psi nk r plus r, okay, what should I do on the right hand side? You can just dictate, I will write.
So in everywhere, small r will be replaced by small r plus capital R.
Correct. So which is only one place, right?
Yes.
So it's just this, and then psi n atomic of r plus capital R minus r dash. Okay. Then what do I do? How do I get this phase factor out? Can I replace this with
that? Will be coming from that psi atomic part.
So what happens
that
to this?
R plus r minus r prime, we can replace it by some another vector.
Correct. So we will take r double dash as r dash minus r, right?
Yes, sir.
So which means that r dash becomes r double dash plus r.
Correct? And if we substitute this e to the power I k dot r prime, then we will
get. Yeah, so this becomes sum over r double dash, right? E to the power I k dot r double dash plus r, and then psi of r minus r double dash, right?
Yes,
so then this e to the power I k dot r will come out,
and what remains is psi n k of
r. Good. Okay. So essentially what we have been able to show is that if I use the atomic wave functions, okay, so remember these are all atomic wave functions, right? And I can use these atomic wave functions and construct a discrete Fourier transform superposition of these atomic wave functions to create another wave function, and that turns out to satisfy the Bloch's theorem. Okay, so this gives me a very natural way to construct wave functions which satisfy the Bloch's theorem. Okay, these functions need not be the eigenfunctions of the Hamiltonian. However, these can serve as a good basis for solving the full eigenvalue problem. Okay. And the reason they will be a good basis is because they automatically satisfy the Bloch's theorem. Okay, so I don't have to impose the Bloch's theorem as a separate part. Okay?
Okay, sir.
Is this step clear to everyone? Yeah? Okay.
Hello.
Yeah. Yes, Krishna.
Sir, why there is a factor of r minus r prime in the atomic part?
So what we are saying is that each wave function can be written as, so each wave function will have some extent, okay? And the wave function is actually located, so what I should be writing here See, essentially, this is a sum over n, okay, Rn. So maybe I should write it more explicitly. Okay. See, suppose I want to look at some point R, okay? Then the wave function here will have some extent. So this is, let's say, 1, 2, 3, and so on, okay? This wave function is localized at 1, okay? So it has a center at R1. This wave function has a center at R2, right? So if I want to look at some general point R, okay, then I will take the oneness wave function. This is what that atomic represents. I'll take the oneness wave function, which is given by e to the power minus R by A, let's say, okay? But what is this R now? This R assumes that you are centered at 0, right? But what is that 0 now? Yeah. That 0 will be either R1, R2, R3, or whatever. Okay. So the atomic wave function, which is localized at, so this is mod of R minus R1 by A. Okay. This is the 1s wave function, which is localized at R1. Correct?
Yeah.
Okay. And similarly, there will be a wave function which is localized at R2. So what we are saying is that all of these wave functions will have some contributions. Maybe they are exponentially small, but maybe they are also of order 1 at some general point R. Okay? The functions are all the same. The functional form is the same. But they have a finite spatial extent, and they can all be superposed onto superposed with a general, with a discrete Fourier transform to construct a new wave function, which is like a block, which actually satisfies the Bloch's theorem. Does this make sense?
Yeah, it's clear. Yeah, one more thing is there. The sure. wave function has also the angular part. What we are doing with that?
The wave function has an angular part, yes.
So we are not considering that that contribution.
No, we are. Okay. See, which is why I started with the 1s, with the hydrogen atom problem. See, we can construct a band. See, this N here, that is very important. Okay. That N here and this N are not exactly the same. What I mean by that is, if you take the 1s orbitals and then try to construct a Bloch wave function out of that, you will get a 1s band. Okay. You can take the px orbitals, py orbitals, pz orbitals, okay, and they are all degenerate. You can construct a linear superposition of those and then use that to construct this kind of a Bloch wave function. You will get a p band. Okay. So like this, you can choose different wave functions, and what essentially happens is this. For example, suppose I take sodium, okay, and the sodium has its valence electron in the 3s, right?
Yeah.
So essentially what I can do is I can take sodium and split it into a core part, which is the first shell and the second shell, and the third shell I can choose it to be the valence part, which is all that is going to mix with the other atoms. So when I'm considering a sodium crystal, okay, then the conduction band that I will get will be the band that will be formed out of the 3s orbitals mixing with each other.
Okay.
You understand, right? So that is basically the picture here, that there is a core part and there is also a part which is giving you the free electrons, or which is giving you the mixing. You understand? So in this way, you can account for the angular dependence also. So it depends on what is the atomic orbital that you have chosen. That kind of a band you will get. You will get a S band or a P band or a D band and things like that. Sometimes you can get SP band also. If they are close in energy, you can get SP hybridization. So you can get SP bands as well. Okay? You can get SPD bands. You understand? And each of these bands will have a certain character. I'm sorry, there is a lot of noise. There is some drilling going on here. So that way you can choose. Okay. So you can choose which is the orbital No, that is playing the most important role in transport processes or in thermodynamic processes, and then construct bands out of them, right? So depending on what bands you choose, you can do either a pseudo potential calculation within density functional theory, which says that there is a core part which is unaffected by the mixing with other atoms, right? And only the valence electrons are interacting with the other core. Or you can do an all electron calculation, where all of the electrons are being incorporated into your full calculation. So you're constructing bands out of all the core orbitals as well as the valence orbital. Does this make sense now?
Yeah. So what I understood is that the psi and k, which is written in the left hand side, and their end denotes the orbitals or vital contribution we are considering, whereas in the RHS, the N is just an index which runs from the different sides.
That's correct. Yes. So this more precise. Okay, just hold on. Okay. I'll make this more precise. So, So here, the atomic and N, right? Now what you're seeing is that this is the that N will represent what kind of a band you are constructing, okay? And M is the site index.
Sir?
Okay.
Yeah. Hello? Yes, Shobhi.
Sir, this high M of atomic orbitals can be also linear combinations of the basis of the atomic.
Absolutely. Yes, yes. So that's what I said. You can take either the PX band alone, or you can construct these, let's say if there is no orbital splitting, if there is no crystal field splitting, for example, then the PX, PY, PZ or all the 5D orbitals, they are degenerate. Okay. And if they're all degenerate, then ideally you should take a linear combination of those and then construct the linear superposition. Yes, you're right.
Sir, but in case of linear combination, how I will choose the coefficients? Because in Kroning-Penney model, like the coefficient,
you will not choose them. See, here what will happen is when you take this form of the Hamiltonian and then form of the wave function and then substitute that into the eigenvalue equation, which is what we did in the Kroning-Penney model also. We did not choose the coefficients. We chose the form of the wave function, either as a traveling wave or a decaying function, and then found the coefficients by substituting that ansatz into the Schrodinger's equation. Then we got a determinant and we substituted the determinant equal to zero and got the energy eigenvalues. Exactly the same thing is going to happen here as well. We are going to choose a basis, an ansatz, okay, and then substitute that into the Schrodinger's equation. And then by looking at the coefficients, by looking at what equation arises, we will get the energy eigenvalues. Okay.
Okay, sir. I understand.
Yeah. Okay, so, right, let me then, so I'll simplify notation quite a bit and let me write this in the following way, psi k of r is sum over n and r e to the power I k dot r, and then b n chi n of r minus r. Okay, I'll write this in this way, and then notice that there is a sum over all the sites and there is a sum over all the degenerate orbitals as well. Okay, and the equation that I want to solve is h psi k is equal to epsilon k psi k. Okay, this is to be solved, and what I'm going to use is this ansatz. Okay, this is the starting ansatz. So the point is that I'm going to now substitute this ansatz into this, but not exactly at this stage. Let me do one more simplification here, which is I will split the h into h atomic plus the delta u. Okay, and the reason I'm doing that is because that this is also inspired from the same ansatz. Because I'm using atomic wave functions as the starting basis, and I'm creating superpositions out of that which satisfies the Bloch's theorem. I will take the Hamiltonian also and split it into a part which is exact in the atomic basis, and then there is a perturbation which is not exact, okay, which actually changes the wave functions to be different from the atomic wave functions, which makes them different. Okay, so given this, what I'm going to do is H atomic plus delta U. Okay, I'm going to take this and then substitute that here. So I will get psi k is equal to epsilon k psi k. Okay, I've done nothing. I've just taken the eigenvalue equation and then split the Hamiltonian into an atomic part and a delta U part. Okay, and now I'm going to take a scalar product from the left hand side of an atomic wave function. I'll tell you what this means in a different notation. Just give me a minute. So delta U times psi k of r dr is equal to epsilon k integral chi m star of r psi k of r dr. Okay, so some of you who are familiar with the Dirac notation, this is what I'm doing. Okay, so h psi k is epsilon k psi k. Okay, so this is basically the eigenvalue problem that I have to solve, right? All I have done in this step is the following. Chi m, I have taken a scalar product with an atomic wave function and I'm writing it like this. That's all. Okay, in expanding this you get an integral. So why am I doing this? Okay, so remember, this is the Bloch's.
Sir, if I want to add delta U as perturbation, mm-hmm. so in that case, can I write the equation as H of AT plus delta U is equal to times psi of K is equal to EK psi K? I mean, this will mean that H atomic plus delta U has exact eigenstate psi K, whose eigenvalue is EK.
That's essentially what we are assuming. See, remember, there are these bn's here which are unknown, right? So okay, yeah. Let me give you a different example. Okay, suppose I tell you that, just 1 minute, huh? So suppose I am trying to solve this problem, okay, but I know that this problem is exactly solvable, h naught is exactly solvable, and by solving h naught I get the full eigen spectrum. Let's say I get this. Okay, can I not choose the full wave function, full eigen function of the Hamiltonian to be bn and n? I can do that, right?
Yes.
That is exactly what I'm doing here. You see,
okay, sir.
The H atomic, the wave functions of the H, the eigen functions of the H atomic are actually chi n's.
Yeah. I have understood now. Actually, so we are taking the
exactly
combinations of those eigenstates.
You look at this bn. In the BN, I have split this into a form, which is a plane wave form and some complex number. Why did I do this? By doing this, I automatically satisfy the Bloch's theorem.
Yeah.
Okay. But essentially, this is a linear superposition of the atomic orbitals, nothing else.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Go on. Okay. Shovik, you had a question?
Sir, I want to know that if delta U is perturbation, then it is very small. And to stabilize the total system, the total energy should decrease to form a crystal.
Well, no. Hold on. So the way I expressed it, you might think that a perturbation is small, but a perturbation, I meant that perturbation to be a term which is added onto a known Hamiltonian. Okay. So in that sense, I'm not trying to do an expansion in the coupling parameter. Your statement would have been correct if I had used the delta U as, in some sense, in a perturbation theory, okay, where I am trying to do some kind of a Taylor's expansion and I expect a convergent expansion because the coupling parameter is small. However, I am not trying to do that. What I am trying to do here is an exact theory.
Okay,
so let me explain. Okay, see, suppose I tell you that H naught is exactly solvable, and H1, if I add this, then I don't know what the solutions are. Okay. So if I know the spectrum of H naught, what I can do is I can construct psi as linear superpositions of the basis of H naught. Okay. Now I take this and then write H psi is equal to E psi, where E is not known. You understand?
Yes, hello? Sir. E to be found out in terms of
E to be found out, right?
And BN.
Huh. So now what I'll do is I'll take this this linear superposition and then substitute here. Okay. So I will get H times sum over N BN N, okay, is equal to E times BN N. Right. And then I can construct the matrix corresponding to this Hamiltonian H. How do I do that? I will take M H BN N is equal to E times this will be BM M N. If this is a delta function, then you will just get, if this is an orthonormal basis, then you will just get one here. Okay. So by doing this, what I can do is I can construct the full matrix H, okay, and then diagonalize that matrix to get the eigenvalues. You understand? Essentially, this becomes an eigenvalue problem then. Okay. There is a summation here, right? So this becomes a set of linear equations for the BNs. And if you write down those linear equations, essentially what you have got is an eigenvalue problem for the Hamiltonian. This is exactly what we are doing here. We are just taking the atomic basis, the atomic orbitals as our basis, constructing linear superpositions of that, and then trying to solve the full problem where not only the atomic potentials are present, but the kinetic energy part is also present, and the mixing from the or the potentials due to other atoms are also present in the problem. Okay. Shovik, is this clear now?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Any other doubts?
No, sir.
Good. Okay. Okay, so what I want to emphasize here is that essentially we started with this, okay, and then we have taken a scalar product of some atomic level, of one particular atomic level, with the full eigenvalue equation to get one particular equation. Okay, so this is one particular equation. So like this, we can get as many equations as we have taken the atomic orbitals in our basis. For example, if you are trying to solve the problem, a problem where you have taken 1s orbitals, okay, then you will, the chi m corresponds to only one 1s orbital, right? So you are only taking the scalar product with a 1s orbital here, localized on some site m, right? So that is what you are trying, that is what you are doing here. And this is what I have expanded in terms of an integral. That's all. The scalar product is expanded here. Now, why do I do this? I am doing this because I know that the H atomic is, or the chi m is actually an eigenfunction of the H atomic. And because it's an eigenfunction, then the eigenfunction, when the H atomic acts on this eigenfunction, I can get the energy eigenvalue. Okay. So the problem can be simplified. Okay, so that is why I am doing this. And now in the next step, I'm going to take the psi k also and then substitute this ansatz that we had started with, the linear superposition of the atomic orbitals. Okay, this is basically, as you can see now, this is actually the LCAO method. This is linear combination of atomic orbitals being used to solve the full crystal problem. Okay, this is actually nothing more than that. So the tight binding method and the LCAO method are essentially identical, okay, except that the LCAO is used mostly in the chemistry context when you're trying to solve molecular orbitals. You're bringing a small number of atoms together. Here we are replacing that with by saying that we are doing a linear superposition of atomic orbitals, okay, or the tight binding method. Okay, so right, so then I will substitute in this the trial wave function chi m star of r times H atomic plus delta U times, here I'm going to write the full thing, sum over N. Okay, just before that, let me do one more step. Okay. So these two, when the H atomic acts on chi m star of R, what I will get is basically the EM. Okay. So EM is the energy eigenvalue corresponding to the mth orbital. So I will get chi m star of R and then psi k of R dr. And then there will be a second term where there is a delta U. Okay. So this will become chi m star of R delta U of R and then psi k of R dr. And the right hand side remains as it is. Okay. So at this step now we can substitute the values of psi k, and now in this you can see that the psi k has a linear superposition of the atomic orbitals, and the atomic orbitals are taken not only from the site M but also from the other sites. Okay, so that is what we are going to use here, and let's first evaluate this part. Okay, so integral chi m star of R psi k of R. So we are going to do this step by step. Okay, we are going to take each of these terms. This term is identical to this term, so I have to evaluate only one of these, and this we will be evaluating separately. Okay, and now you see why we are doing this. You see that this ek, this epsilon k, is the exact eigenvalue. Remember, this is the problem that we are trying to solve. Okay, h psi k is equal to epsilon k psi k. So the epsilon k is the exact eigenvalue. Okay, and this is the exact eigenvalue. And what you see here is that epsilon k is EM, which is the atomic orbital energy, times something plus a correction. Okay, so you see that the dispersion that we want by solving the full problem is coming out to be the EM, okay, with some correction plus an extra correction which is coming from the other atoms. Okay, so this is the essence of the tight binding method, that you're starting from the atomic orbital basis, and essentially the dispersion is coming out to be corrections to the atomic orbital energies. So if the 1s orbital had some energy, right, by mixing of these atomic orbitals you are constructing a whole band of energies, but those band of energies are centered around the same orbital that you had started with. Okay, so essentially what we are saying is that if there are orbitals which look like this, okay, and then there is a mixing, then remember when we had just two, we got one bonding and one antibonding, and the average was just here. Okay, so essentially here, by mixing all of these, we are creating a whole band of energies, okay, which is centered around the atomic orbital energy. So that is essentially the idea. Okay. Okay. So the first term is what we are considering now, and we will substitute the psi k of R that we started with here. So what we will get then is the following: sum over N and R e to the power I k dot R bn of R chi n of R minus R dr. Okay. Right. Now this we can split into two parts. One is when R is equal to zero, okay, that is on site, and the other part when R is not equal to zero. So on site we will get bm plus n and R not equal to zero integral e to the power I k dot R can be taken outside, and this becomes chi m star of R chi n of R minus capital R. Okay, now let me explain what is happening here. So if you see, if I take R equal to zero, or separate this summation into two parts where R is equal to zero and R is not equal to zero, then we are saying that there is a scalar product of two atomic orbitals which are on the same site, or on different sides. Okay, so if I take two atomic orbitals on the same side and take their scalar product, I should just get delta mn. Okay, for example, the summation here could be over all the p orbitals. Okay, and there could be px, there could be py, there could be pz, right? But this m here, this chi m, is a specific orbital. For example, this could be a px orbital. And if I take a scalar product of the px orbital with the py, I will get zero. Okay, only the px, px term will survive, which means that there will be a delta mn, and this bn will be reduced to bm. Okay, so that is why this can be split into two parts. One is when r is equal to zero, and because the atomic orbital basis is an orthonormal basis, you will get a Kronecker delta here. And this part will remain, and this part is not zero because you can see here that there is an overlap of wave functions on different sides. So this r is not zero, right? So this is, for example, px on site one, and this could be py on site two. Okay, or this could be px itself on site two, right? So the second term here is representing the overlap of wave functions, of the atomic wave functions, on different sites. Okay, so the first term here splits into two parts. One is just the coefficient, and the second term relates to the overlap of the different atomic wave functions on different sites. Is this step clear,
sir?
Yeah,
sir. In the second stage, m and n should not be converted, right? Because 1s of one side and 2p of second side can be interact.
Yes, that's correct. But you will not take the superposition of those, because see, 1s and 2p will be very different in energy. Okay, so normally when you construct a single band, then you construct a single band out of atomic levels which are very close in energy. Do you see what I'm saying? See, for example, if you want to construct molecular orbitals, okay, you will take single atom orbitals which are close in energy.
Yes, sir. So, sir, I am asking that in the second term, there is chi m star and chi n r of r minus capital R. So,
that's correct.
These should summation cancelled, and we just put a constant and we integrate chi r, chi of r minus capital R dr. No summation.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's correct. So, no, I didn't understand. So, do we need to make any modification here? This is M actually. Sorry, this is not N. This is M.
Sir, I understood. I am saying that I think summation should not be there in the next step. As
in there next step, is summation over, should not be there?
Summation over N. It just a constant as a function of M. Because 1s of one side and 2p of second side cannot interact.
I agree. However, suppose I want to consider the formation of a p band. Okay, when I am considering the formation of a p band, then n here, right, the n in the first ansatz that we started with corresponds to a summation over xyz. Okay, this n here would represent px, py, pz. Do you see that?
Yes, sir, but I think
no. So let's go ahead. So suppose I tell you that the px on site one and the py on site two, will they be orthonormal to each other?
Yeah,
they will not be. See, because this is centered on site two.
So that is what I am pointing out. So the summation should be continue, but should the summation should continue, right?
Yes, and what I am claiming is that the summation will continue, so the summation will not go away, because the scalar product is being taken over degenerate orbitals or orbitals which are very close in energy but centered at different sites. So symmetry considerations do not apply. See, normally if I consider, take a single site, then because of symmetry there is orthonormality. Okay, but if I take two different sites, then the symmetry considerations don't apply. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
I understand.
Okay, so that is the first term. Now let's look at the second term. There should be a nice way to just erase the whole thing, but sorry. Okay, so let me just write the answer for the first term. Okay, what we had started out to do was to solve this problem. Psi k is equal to epsilon k psi k. Okay, and what we had arrived at is the following: integral chi m star of r psi k of r dr is equal to sum over n and capital R. We got bm plus sum over n capital R not equal to 0 e to the power I k dot R, and an overlap of these orbitals. So Shovik, just to make one more point clear, what we are also saying here is that if I had considered a non-degenerate orbital, okay, so which means, let's say I take a 2s orbital, so forget spin degeneracy, but there is no L and M, right? Then in that case, I will only get the chi 1s, but even that on different sides will be non-zero. Okay, but this sum over n will go away because there is a non-degenerate orbital. Okay, all of this will become just b0 and so on. Is that point clear?
Yes, sir.
The number of coefficients that we have, the bn's that we have, is equal to the degeneracy of the orbitals that we are considering. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Yeah. Okay, so and then the next term that we had was chi m star of r delta u of r times psi k of r. Okay, and that again we can split into two parts, one where r is equal to 0 and the other where r is not equal to 0. Bn integral chi m star of r delta u of r chi n of r. Okay, so this is the first term, then the second term becomes n and r is not equal to 0, e to the power I k dot r integral, same thing, but the chi n will now be r minus capital R. So now we know all of these terms. So by putting these together, okay, the final equation that we get is as follows. Let me write that. Okay. Yeah. So what we get finally from all of this is this: Ek minus Em times Bm plus Ek minus Em and then there is a overlap term, overlap of the wave functions, okay, but then there is a sum over n, right, overlap of wave functions at different sites, okay. And then this becomes equal to the sum over n bn integral. This is the matrix element of delta u on one side, okay, plus another term where there is matrix element of delta u but between the atomic orbitals on different sites. Okay. So matrix element on different sites. Okay. So what we see from here is the following. Suppose I tell you that delta U was zero, okay, which means there was no mixing between the different atoms, right? Then you see that the right hand side is going to be zero. Okay. What that would mean is that the left hand side will give you Ek is equal to Em if delta U was zero, which is the correct limit, because if delta U zero, there is no mixing between the atoms and the energy eigenvalues will be just equal to the atomic energy eigenvalues, nothing else. Okay. However, because there is a mixing between the different atoms and mixing between the different orbitals on different atoms, right? Because of that, the energy eigenvalue is different from the atomic energy. Okay. And that is the equation when we solve, right? We will get a full system of equations. And once we solve that system of equations, we will get a sequence of energy eigenvalues, and those will represent the band structure. Okay, so that is the main idea of this tight binding method. And let's just apply this very quickly to the problem of S band from a single atomic S level. Okay.
Sir, if the M should be capital M, okay, capital E suffix M, right?
I'm sorry?
So in the left hand side, epsilon k minus em bm plus epsilon k minus em.
Correct. Yeah, this is okay. Capital em. Yeah, that's correct. Yeah, so is the philosophy of the tight binding method clear now, that we are starting from the atomic limit, constructing linear superpositions of the atomic wave functions, using that linear superposition to solve the full problem of a Hamiltonian, which has been separated into the atomic part of the Hamiltonian, which means purely central potential located on each atom. And then there is a mixing between different atoms, which means that the nucleus of the second atom, for example, could be attracting the electrons of the first atom. Okay. Or the electrons of the second atom are repelling the electrons of the first atom. All of that is included in the delta U. Plus, most importantly, in delta U, there is also the kinetic energy part also. Okay, so there are a lot of things which are included in the delta U part, right, which are not included in the H atomic, right? So these are mutually exclusive, but the delta U plays the most important part in constructing the band structure. That's the idea. Okay, so let's now apply this to the problem of an S band, okay, which is non-degenerate. So that will be simpler. So essentially what we are saying is, Bn is zero except for a 1s level. Okay, so Bn is zero for all n except for a 1s level, which means I'm only going to consider one single coefficient. Okay, remember the number of coefficients that I have to find are equal to the number of non-degenerate or equal to the number of degenerate orbitals that I'm considering. So if I'm considering a D band, for example, I would have 5 B coefficients. If I'm considering an S band, it's only 1. If I'm considering a P band, it's only 3. If I'm considering an F band, it means it is 7. Okay. Now, depending on crystal field splitting, suppose I have a T2G EG splitting. Okay. Then I can consider a pure T2G band, which means I need to consider again only 3 coefficients. EG band will have a double degeneracy, so I need to consider only 2 coefficients. Okay. So that's the main idea. I suppose all of you know crystal field splitting, right? Does anybody does not know crystal field splitting? Good, all of you know. Okay, so let me write this equation for purely the S band. So there was a first part, and then there was a second part, which was, yeah.
Can you explain briefly what is that crystal field splitting?
Okay.
I don't know that.
Sure. Suppose I give you a hydrogen atom, then you will tell me that the energy eigen, the eigenfunctions of that are basically 1s, 2s, 2p, 3s, 3p, 4s, 3d, and so on, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Now, this d orbitals that you find for a hydrogen atom are all degenerate. So you get 5d orbitals, right?
Yeah.
Okay. And these 5d orbitals, why are they degenerate? Can you tell me that? Do you know why are all these p orbitals degenerate? Why are all the d orbitals degenerate? Why do they have the same energy? Why doesn't their energy depend on the orientation, for example? That's because there is...
Is it due to the rotational symmetry?
Yes, it's because of the spherical symmetry.
Okay.
So because of the spherical symmetry, you can't pick out any particular orbital and say that that has a higher energy. Okay. So there is a degeneracy among the different orbitals. Okay. Essentially, what we are saying is that the energy depends purely on the n. Of course, there are other corrections, but let's stick to the basic model. Okay. But now when you come to a crystal, you can see that the potential is now going to be distorted. It's not a spherically symmetric potential. Okay. And the crystal, because of its symmetries, will impose an additional potential which is angle dependent, which is which does not have the same spherical symmetry as the central potential. Okay. And that crystal field can now break this degeneracy and give you different and give you this, for example, splitting between the d orbitals as t2g and eg. Okay.
Okay, so the direction dependence leads to the d orbitals taking up various other energies.
That's correct. Yeah, the energy also splits. So in fact, the degeneracy splits into the in some cases in depending on what symmetries you have, and this is something that the chemistry people can tell you better. The EG can be higher and the T2G can be lower, or it can be reversed also. Okay. So I don't remember here. I mean, does somebody know this? In what geometry the EG is higher, in what geometry the T2G is higher?
Sir, in octahedral geometry, EG is higher.
Okay. And in which one the EG is lower?
Sir, there is E in T2. In tetrahedral geometry, the E is lower.
Okay, okay. Yeah, and this EG and T2G are basically group theory terminology, which I'm also not very clear about. But... yeah, I'm sure you can read about it. But basically, that's what is happening. You get a non-spherically symmetric potential, and because of that, the degeneracy is lifted. Okay?
Okay, sir.
All right. So the oneness level, for the oneness level, we just have one coefficient, and that one coefficient just separates out from the entire equation. Okay? So it's essentially just one linear equation, which is being multiplied by B0. And since B0 is not zero, we directly get the equation for the eigen energy. So what is it going to be? It's going to be the following. Phi. Wait. One second. Maybe we should continue this next time. But let me just write this and explain it. We will again do this next time, this last equation. R is equal to okay. So let me explain this briefly, okay? This ES is the atomic energy of the 1s orbital, of 1s, okay? And this EK is the exact eigen energy that we need, right? So what you can see from here is that I can write the EK minus ES, right? If I take it common from these two, then I'll get 1 plus something equal to something plus something, okay? Now notice, what is that something plus something? This something is a local integral, which means I'm integrating two wave functions, okay, on the same site and taking the matrix element of this extra potential on the same site. So this is going to be highly non-trivial, Okay, this is going to be of the order of 1 in the sense that the both the wave functions are centered on the same site. However, look at this part. Okay, this part is the matrix element of the delta u between 1s orbitals centered on two different sites. In fact, you can see here that the r is not equal to 0, right? So you can expect that the most significant contribution will come from the nearest neighbors. And in fact, you can also expect that as you go from nearest neighbor to next nearest neighbor and so on, okay, this contribution will go on decreasing. Okay, so the major the first level approximation that you can make in this is to truncate this summation at the nearest neighbors. Okay, and that is also one of the most important things that is done in the tight binding model, which is you take the matrix element of this perturbation of this delta u of r only between nearest neighbors. Okay, and this matrix element between the nearest neighbor orbitals is what gives you the actual dispersion. Okay, and how does this happen? This we will do in the next class. Okay, but if there are any doubts at this point, please let me know.
Does delta u include electron-electron interaction? Because in blocks, I'm confused whether in blocks we consider electron-electron interaction.
See, essentially, you can actually consider everything except the atomic part. Okay. So, because if you remember, we had written the total Hamiltonian as H atomic plus delta u, right? So this delta u can be effectively anything that you want, okay? Because remember, we are always solving an exact, we are solving this exactly. So if you had this, all we are doing is we are using the exact eigenbasis of H naught as a full basis for the full problem, as a basis for the full problem, okay? So in some sense, we are constructing wave functions which are linear superpositions of the atomic orbitals. So effectively the H1 or the delta u can have anything that you want. Okay. But in practice, what happens is that these elements cannot be computed exactly. The reason is that the delta u of r, if you start putting in here the electron-electron interactions, then you get, the problem becomes intractable. Okay. So effectively what you do is you throw away the electron-electron interactions, and within density functional theory, you construct these kind of matrix elements. You solve the problem in a single electron framework and then use quantum many body methods to bring in the electron-electron interactions. Okay. So that's what is done in practice. But in principle, yes, you can include anything that you want.
In Bloch theorem, we don't, right?
I'm sorry?
When we consider Bloch theorem, we consider electron-electron interaction?
The Bloch wave functions are supposed to be, the Bloch's theorem is valid for multi-electron wave functions also.
Okay,
so essentially what you are saying is that the wave function is actually given by R1, R2, the many electron wave function should be something like this, if there are n electrons in the system, okay? Now, what I can do is I can construct a linear superposition, which is 1, 2, up to n, and a product basis of the Bloch wave functions corresponding to each electron, okay? Psi nk of R1. And then psi nk of R2 and so on. Of course, this will be a Slater determinant. I'm not writing this properly. I can construct a Slater determinant of the single particle wave functions, which are all Bloch wave functions. And because each of them is a Bloch wave function, when I do an R1 plus A, okay, there will be an R1 plus A in one of them, and that will pick up a phase factor. So the many body wave function will also satisfy the Bloch's theorem.
Okay.
Yeah.